Okay, so let's start. So it's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Yossiri Adulyasak. Yossiri is a professor at HEC Montreal. He holds the Canada Research Chair in Supply Chain Analytics. So his research interests lie in supply chain and in solving some of the most important problems related to supply chain. And today's talk is in line with, I think, very well with his research interests. So it deals with robust vehicle routing problems and a solution framework for these types of problems. So Yossiri, you have the floor.
Thank you, Walter. Thank you for a nice introduction. And thank you, everyone, for attending this talk. So my name is Yossiri. So as you can see, I have PowerPoint. I'm in the business school, so we tend to use PowerPoint. So my presentation today is going to be around the vehicle routing problem. So it could be a little bit different from perhaps some of the talks that you have seen earlier. This one, the focus is basically on this specific application and how we can leverage a robust optimization framework to actually improve the planning aspect of the of this type of transportation and delivery problem. So just to give you a little bit of motivation, this is a very simple example. So why, you know, this become quite interesting and why we are very interested in this, right? So vehicle routing problem is actually, you know, a very well-known problem, extension of traveling salesman problem. So many people have tried to solve it. Most of the effort, you know, were spent on, let's say, on the deterministic case. It's very highly challenging. Even for deterministic case, it's also highly combinatory. So that they make the problem highly sophisticated. But then when we move into the real world context, we know that, you know, with so many uncertainty, in particular, the travel time and the other factors, right? There are a lot of inherent uncertainty that we have to deal with on the daily basis. So our main question would be, you know, look like we know that assuming everything is deterministic, assuming everything is perfectly known, would that be realistic in this context, right? But when we look into uncertainty and we look into, you know, the issues around how we can sensibly extend the, you know, vehicle routing problem for this more practical setting, what are the main challenges that we have to face? So I give you this very simple example. Looking into, you know, this type of setting, you want to start, you know, from the point A to the point B. Let's say the point A is your house. The point B is actually, you know, maybe a place where you have to attend a meeting, right? And then you have to be there by 11:20 so that, you know, you can be there on time. And then you have two choices. You have the route number one and you have the route number two, right? So basically in the route number one, let's say I collect, you know, the historical data, I come up with a simple analysis and I want to see what will be the probability that I'm going to be there on time, right? And on top of that, you know, you can actually think about the context where you open up, you know, your Google Map and see what would be the expected time that you can be there, right? In terms of traveling from A to B. So the result look like if I take the route number, route A, it's gonna take me 12.4 minutes and the probability looks quite good, it's 80%, but well, I still have 20% chance of missing the deadline, right? So let's say in the route number two, I look into the map and then, wow, this look actually better. So I have like 12.2 minutes, right? Every time is lower, probability that I'm gonna be there is actually much, much higher, as low as 95%. So my sensible choice looking into this information around, you know, the uncertainty around travel time would be to choose the route number two, right? If you look into this perspective of the information from the data that I collected. So let's turn things a little bit differently. I look a little bit more into details. Let's say I have access, you know, to the distribution of the travel time that I have. And then I look into, you know, like the possibilities of going with the route number one. Let's say the route number one, most of the time, you know, even though it takes a little bit longer, if you remember the average is almost the same, just a little bit higher. But then when I'm gonna be late, it seems to still be not so bad, right? 22% with probability of 20%. But then if I'm late, I'm only 2 minutes late. In terms of the route number two, let's say if, you know, I look into the profile of my distribution, there could be some incident of accident, right? And if that accident happened, I look into the distribution and I see that, look, for some cases, even though it doesn't happen too often, but if it happened, it can cause a big delay, right? So by looking into this information, I basically see that, well, if accident happened, and even 5% of the time, I could spend so much more time on the route and I'm gonna have a huge delay, right? So if you look into this two perspective, these two pieces of information come from the same type of underlying distribution. So the basic question is that when we think about, you know, this type of uncertainty, what would be the good approach to allow us to make some sensible decision, right? This is the first type of the issue that we face when we deal with uncertainty. In transportation, in vehicle routing, in deterministic setting, we assume that everything is known. So we don't necessarily need to deal with this type of situation. So if you follow, you know, the information from the first setting, you may prefer route number two because it has lower average, higher probability. But if you look into the second piece of information right here, maybe many of you would now change your mind and perhaps think that the route number one would be better. So these, you know, challenges in terms of what would be the good decision is actually quite, you know, challenging in the context of uncertainty, right? The other challenge that we want to address is basically, we know that deterministic vehicle routing is so difficult to solve, right? You know, we are thinking about having exact algorithm for 100 customers is already difficult. And enumeration is impossible, right? Now, looking into the sense of uncertainty, the very basic version that we can come up with could be, how about if we use some kind of sampling approach, right, to be able to incorporate this type of uncertainty. So the sampling approach is basically you start to draw some samples, right? And then you start to construct the distribution of your outcome, and then you can actually start making decision based on this outcome, right? The issue lies in the fact that you would necessarily need a lot of samples, right, to have, let's say, the good representation of your uncertainty. And that become the issue that come together with the use of the stochastic optimization. And then in particular with the sampling based approach, this is something that most researchers need to deal with in terms of scalability, how we can actually be able to tackle that, right? So that is also the second challenge that we could face. Then come in the third challenge that we can basically face. We know that in many cases, you simply do not have enough information, or things could change based on what you have observed in the past, right? So in many cases, you may not even know about the uncertainty, the underlying uncertainty of your distribution. And then if you don't have that, how can we deal with that, right? These are different type of uncertainty challenges that we have to deal with when we move from deterministic vehicle routing into the vehicle routing with uncertainty, right? So putting that into perspective, right? We want to look into different possibilities, how we can deal with that, how we can move vehicle routing from that into the one with uncertainty. First option could be stochastic programming. Everyone would know this one very well. We assume that we have underlying distribution of input and we want to see how the solution look like. On the other hand, you would have, you know, some kind of traditional robust optimization, right? You assume some kind of intervals of your uncertainty, but then one thing that we could face is that we find out that in many cases, these solutions seem to be a little bit too conservative, right? Because sometimes if you do not really constrain your uncertainty so much, then you may end up having a solution that's too conservative. And if you think about the context of vehicle routing problem, we may not want to be too conservative all the time, right? Because you actually need to dispatch your vehicle, you will repeat your operation almost every single day. So being too conservative may actually mean that you have to spend too much of the cost and the prices in order to keep your operation going, right? So we want to look into the efficiency and the performance of the solution approach that can actually combine this type of, you know, two perspectives. Can we actually ensure that we have reasonable performance in terms of the solution that we obtain, and at the same time we can also be sufficiently robust? So that's why we look specifically into how about if we put the distributionally robust optimization perspective into the vehicle routing in order to deal with these three challenges that we face. All right, so our talk today will be based on the two papers that I worked with my colleagues with Patrick Jaye at MIT and in the paper in 2016. That is the case when we deal with the case of deadlines in the operation. And the second paper, we actually extend that framework, generalize it, and then we look into the case when we essentially deal with the time windows, but basically it's a sub time window with time window assignment, right? I'm gonna go through these two talks and going to actually give you a perspective of how we actually deal with that. So in the first one, we actually look into the two different objectives, one based on stochastic optimization, the other one based on the distributionally robust optimization. So in this context, we look into the typical operation that you can face on the daily basis, right? You have delivery operation, or you have collection operation, or you have, you know, any personal scheduling operations, and you have some kind of deadlines that you have to meet. So in this context, the main considerations of your delivery is basically to be able to reach the deadlines on time. You don't want to be too late, and you don't want, you know, you to delay your operations. How can we actually look into this uncertainty of the travel time and have the planning of the route so that you can visit all the locations in such a way that the deadline violation can actually be minimized, right? So this is a context of the first work that we consider. So as you know, we have a lot of challenges with the traffic, with the unknown uncertainty. How can we actually solve this problem, right? So when we look into, at that time, when we look into the different frameworks that deal with this type of context, when you have the deadline, most of the paper, as you see, essentially deal with the case where they assume that the uncertainty can be represented by set of scenarios. Those go along with sampling-based approaches where you actually assume that you have some underlying scenario, underlying distribution, you draw scenarios, and then you use stochastic optimization to solve it. And it turned out even with that case, it's actually quite difficult to solve. Most of the paper do not even deal with VRP, right? And then they actually start with the MTSP with no vehicle capacity constraint, no demand consideration. So it's even for that case at that time, when we look back, it's still already quite challenging to solve. And if you look into number of scenarios, most of the time, number of scenarios are not large at all. Some paper consider just a few scenarios, which kind of, it might make sense from like, operation perspective that people can try to solve for the worst case, the best case, and most likely case. But if you really want to capture the mechanism of the uncertainty, underlying uncertainty, you need to really have a very large number of scenarios. And that becomes the issue when we use this type of technique. On the other hand, when you look into some of the framework, right, in terms of robust optimization at that time, most of the framework rely essentially on budgeted uncertainty. And as you know, that is a quite flexible representation of uncertainty, but at the same time, we know that it can be as well too conservative to be used in practice in some of the type of the operations that you have to face on the daily basis, right? So one thing that my colleague, Patrick Jaye, actually worked with, Melvin Sim and also another researcher, Jin Ki, is basically to propose another type of risk index to basically allow them to be able to come up with a distributionally robust optimization framework to be able to address, this type of issue. The focus in that paper that they look at is basically also on the TSP, meaning like there's no demand, it's only one single vehicle. So we look into that framework and we want to actually see how can we leverage this type of idea and use that in a context that is more practical in the context of vehicle routing problem. So that become, let's say, the foundation of the motivation that we use in this work and then the work that I'm going to show you later on. So again, the ultimate objectives that we want to do is to satisfy all the deadlines. And we consider in this one, we want to be able to also address a question: what is the quality of the robust solution that you would have if you were to use this type of approach versus the solid quality of the solution of the stochastic optimization, right? So in order to be able to answer that, we need to come up with a very scalable approach. So we come up with some decomposition technique to be able to have the unified version of the decomposition that can be used to tackle both the stochastic and also the distributionally robust optimization for this VRP, right? So let me give you a little bit of the context. So in stochastic model, we take the version that has been introduced by David Morton in that paper in 2003. So we basically want to look into the probability of deadline violation, right? So if you know the distribution of your travel time, it's gonna be easy. You can actually try to look into what is the probability that you have that exceed the point where you have the deadline, right? And in order to actually look into multiple location, we're gonna take that sum of the probability of deadline violations, all right? That is a part of the stochastic. The robust optimization, we're gonna look into a different measures. Again, we do not have distribution, so we have to have some kind of measures that represent the quality of solution, right? So in this kind of context, we actually look into what we call utility function. So to be more precise, we actually have this utility function, right? The higher the value, the more dissatisfied you are. And we come up with, you know, the way to actually incorporate this utility function in the VRP context. So in order to optimize this one, we're gonna look into one index that we call lateness index in our paper, or violation index in the original paper of J.A. et al. In 2016, basically to look into some representation of how close you are in terms of satisfying the deadline, all right? So in this one, we want to have some kind of representation. If you think about the fact that you don't actually know about the uncertainty, but you want to have some number that represent the fact that if the mass, you know, of your uncertainty distribution seem to get close to the deadline versus the one that you can ensure that, you know, even with the unknown distribution, you can ensure that you have a higher chance and higher likelihood that you will actually arrive at that location much earlier than the deadline. We want to have some index that represent that fact. So for example, the root number one and number two, even we do not know the full distribution, but let's say if you know the minimum, the maximum, and then expected value, we want some number to represent the fact that these possible mass of distribution are gonna allow you to be able to satisfy the deadline violation. I'm gonna show you the form of the function that we use on the next slide. So that is what we call lateness index. So in order to, first of all, in order to address stochastic, just very quickly, we look into the probability of violating the deadline, and then we take the sum of probability, right? And that basically, the sum probability is actually the, let's say the bound if you want to take the joint probability function, right? But we look into the sum because it allows us to represent, you know, multiple deadline in combination at the same time. And at the same time, when you actually look into the sampling-based approach, that sum turned out to be the same as the expected number of deadline violation, right? Because in the sampling-based approach, we can actually compute the joint distribution from each sample directly. So that is the case of stochastic. It's quite simple in terms of formulation. We want to minimize the sum of probability of deadline violation. And then I have this routing set, which I'm gonna present later on. It's a big set of all the variable and constraints that represent the vehicle routing. But the part that we deal with uncertainty is basically this objective function. All right, so this is how we model the sampling-based approach. Very simple. You actually have one variable that represent that check if you violate or do not violate the deadline under each sample of your scenario, right? And then for that sample, for this variable, it's gonna be binary. If it equal to one, it means that you violate the deadline. If it equal to zero, it means that you can satisfy the deadline under that sample of distribution. This is very simple. And then for the reformulation, we actually try to project, you know, this big number of constraints, project out in the subproblem and try to replace it with a set of cuts so that you don't need to deal with a large number of variables and constraints explicitly in the problem. This is how we actually model the stochastic. very simple. The only thing we do is project out the part that is massive and then replace it by a set of cuts. So indeed, you have to use some kind of cutting plane approach in order to start adding these cuts in order to come up with the bounds, the upper bound, lower bound of the optimal solution. Now for the robust optimization. The basic idea is that we're gonna take this utility function and the violation index that has been proposed by JA, so that paper published in OR in 2016. They propose it for the shortest path problem, and they also show it can be extended for traveling salesman. So we take that utility function and we want to actually extend it for the case of vehicle routing problem. So this utility function look like the one that I show at the top. So for those of you who are not familiar, with this type of function, it's basically one type of the risk measure function that people in transportation, they use in order to represent utility or disutility based on the travel time that you encounter when you go along, the network of transportation. So if you look into this function, this function represents how dissatisfied you are, right? So the alpha is a parameter. So if, in the realistic setting, in terms of calculating this function, you would need alpha at an input, right? So let's say alpha is a fixed parameter, the constant that is available. And then you can see that this utility function is the inclusive function of the travel time, right? So the higher the travel time, the higher you are dissatisfied, right? And then in this type of context, we're gonna adopt this function and embed this in our optimization. So the idea to deal with the ambiguity in your distribution, the fact that you would not know exactly your distribution, is basically to put supremum in terms of the worst case uncertainty that you can actually have when you face the travel time uncertainty. So you can see that we add supremum right here, and then it's gonna take the worst case of the distribution. So under some certain family of distribution, there are some kind of like closed form function. In our paper, we look into the case when you have minimum, maximum, and the expected value as the description or the parameter of the distribution. So that can represent, for example, triangular distribution, uniform distribution, or some other type of distribution that take this family. So for certain type of family of distribution, if the closed form were to be available, now you can change this form with supremum into a function without supremum. So we're gonna show that later on in the slide as well. The issue in the robust is that now we need to deal with this supremum. And at the same time, we need to actually optimize this type of disutility function, right? So before that, I told you that when you want to actually calculate disutility, you need to have alpha available as an input, and then you try to actually calculate disutility. In our case, when we actually look into this one, the other way to actually calculate this type of disutility, instead of trying to precisely estimate alpha, we can actually try to set the disutility, right, to be equal to the deadline value. And then we try to actually find the minimum value of alpha, right? So we try to actually, instead of trying to have estimation of alpha, you can ensure that this utility of going through the network can also be minimized by trying to find the minimum value of alpha. So what it means is that the lower the alpha, the less that you have to try to penalize the travel time that you have in order to allow you to be satisfied, right? So the function on the top, when we try to optimize, then you can actually, instead of having this type of function with assumption of alpha, you can actually minimize the alpha subject to the case where you set this utility to be exactly equal to the deadline. And then that also become the equivalent optimization problem that you can actually optimize through optimizing the value of alpha. The travel time that you see here would be the result of the route that you choose, right? So whenever you change the route, you're gonna change the time right here. So you want to ensure that for each route, you can actually find the optimal value of risk tolerance parameter alpha right here, or what we call the lateness index. So the idea is that we want to minimize this value. Just to show you how this function look like. So this function, when alpha is greater than zero, it's gonna take the value between zero and infinity, right? And then for the deadline, that is impossible for you to satisfy, meaning that even though you like you do the best that you can, it's still gonna be too late for you to satisfy the deadline. This tolerance index alpha gonna be equal to infinity, right? But if in the worst case, like whatever you do, you can guarantee to satisfy the deadline. Let's say you have only one customer, and that customer has a deadline of, you know, the end of the day, but entire day you have only one customer, it takes you 30 minutes to deliver to that customer. So in that case, if you guarantee to be able to satisfy the deadline 100%, the alpha is gonna be equal to zero. So anything in between, if you start having the risk, the alpha is gonna take value between zero and infinity. So we want to be able to minimize this value of alpha, right? So this is the case, the three cases that we can look at, and we want to actually look at the root that can actually minimize the sum of this alpha, all right? So this is how optimization look like when you have multiple deadlines that you have to deal with. And this is the function of our optimization problem, right? So then how does our formulation, entire formulation look like? So we're gonna have this type alpha function, right? And this is the C function, the same disutility function. We just put this as a function of alpha and T. We're gonna set this one equal to the deadline so that we can optimize the alpha. And then this is a calculation of the total travel time based on the route that you choose. And this one is basically the Slater condition. So we add Slater condition to ensure that the worst case, the supremum in the worst case, the supremum of this, in the worst case, the expected travel time that you're gonna take gonna be lower than or equal to the deadline. So you want to guarantee that at least in the expected value, the worst case of expected value, you can still reasonably be able to satisfy the deadline, right? Otherwise, it's like you plan to fail and it would not make sense in the operation context. At the same time, this Slater condition, for those who are aware of, you know, duality, those type of things, by having this Slater condition would allow you to derive dual formulation, which allow you to do multiple tricks to be able to solve this problem. So these Slater conditions serve two purposes. First one, we ensure that expected value can still satisfy the deadline. Secondly, we can also be able to obtain some nice duality formulation. So in order to deal with the supremum, as you remember, we have the supremum. We found out that, you know, for the case of the representation of the uncertainty that looked like this, right? You know the expected value, and then you know the minimum and maximum. We can actually rely on the transformation based on Edmonton-Mandelski. So we change this supremum into this function. So you can see that the supremum is gone, and then now we have a closed form that is also basically convex. And then you can actually solve it by using the subgradient for a fixed set of the route that you know, the sequence of the deliveries, and then you can actually try to optimize based on that input. So for this function, then we can actually derive subgradient, and the idea is basically to use subgradient in our path generation process, right? So this is how the robust vector routing problem look like. You're gonna have very similar formulation, except that we're gonna keep adding this subgradient to improve the lessness value of the objective function. And then we continue to optimize using that idea. By generating the subgradient cut, we will be able to improve the quality of the solution. All right, so just to give you a little bit of idea, stochastic versus robust, again, in the stochastic, we look into the probability, right? So if you look into probability, we just look into the probability based on different root. If probability is better, it means that that root is actually better. For the robust, it's basically based on the risk tolerance. So if you look into this, for example, if my deadline equal to 180, right? I look into the root number two, right? The root number two like this, I would see value alpha. I look into the root number one, I would have this value alpha. So I'm gonna choose the one that give lower risk index, right? So the alpha is lower, going to be my preference. So the idea is basically also based on the deadline, you may end up having choosing different route because, for example, if you look into the deadline that equal to 160, the route number two now gives a lower value of alpha, right? So these preference going to change based on the deadline that you have, and then the route going to be chosen based on, you know, this alpha value. So the basic idea is that in the subproblem, we're going to evaluate, right? What would be the optimal, what would be the value of alpha that you're going to have for that given route? And then in the master problem, you continue to generate different route. In the subproblem, we continue to give you kind of feedback of how good, how risky this route is. And then you can continue generating the cut to give that back as a feedback through the subgradient mechanism. So this is how the routing set look like. So basically we want some variable to capture, you know, the flow of the vehicle to each location with the deadline. Because in the subproblem, we need to evaluate each of the location with deadline separately, right? Because even though it's the same route, but then the time for you to take from that origin until that destination with the deadline for each location gonna be different. So we want to have some variable to capture the total of the time that would represent in terms of the time it would take for you to reach each of the deadlines that you have to serve. So that is the first set of the constraint. We kind of use some kind of like multi-commodity flow, but only to actually capture, you know, the sequence of the service to each of the location with the deadline. But then at the same time, we also have the routing variables. So the routing variable capacity constraint are almost the same as in deterministic vehicle routing, so that we can actually use, you know, this type of representation of the subtool elimination constraint for those who are aware of you know, vehicle routing with capacity and subtool elimination constraint. DAX is, you know, very efficient separation algorithm. So by reformulating it following, you know, deterministic vehicle routing constraint, we can actually leverage the separation algorithm that are already developed and are very efficient in this context. So by doing this, it would allow us to be able to embed the robust and at the same time the stochastic optimization framework into the decomposition framework that are proven to be efficient in the deterministic vehicle routing context. All right, just to quickly summarize again, this is how both formulation look like. You can see a lot of similarity. We're gonna have this cut continue that are going to be added in the decomposition framework. In the first, you know, iteration, you're gonna try to determine some route. You have absolutely no idea how good this route is. You give that route to the subproblem. Subproblem give back some kind of feedback. In stochastic, it's gonna tell you what would be the probability of the deadline violation. In the robust optimization, it's gonna tell you the risk index. And in addition to that, it's gonna give you back this type subgradient cut so that you can add and you can actually continue to improve the lower bound. So both look quite similar. So that's the reason why we can actually have the unified decomposition to deal with both of them in a similar fashion. So the way we implement it is basically, for those who are familiar with Bender decomposition, it seemed to be more and more efficient to actually try to implement, you know, Bender decomposition in the run and cut fashion, right? So in order to do that, we basically, you know, start solving the master problem using a run and brow approach. And then we use a callback in the, you know, the solver whenever you find a feasible solution. It doesn't need to be an optimal solution of that relaxation of the master. It can be any feasible solution. You can start to add cut based on those feasible solutions, right? And then you continue to explore the single tree. Every time you find feasible, then you can go to the subproblem for either stochastic or robust. In stochastic, you get logic cut. In robust, you get subgradient cut. And then you add those cut to the master problem. At the same time, as I mentioned earlier, we can also leverage the cuts that already exist and separation algorithm that already exists in capacitated vehicle routing problem. And that would allow us to add the cut even for the fractional solution. So any node, even with fractional solution, you don't need to wait until you get like a integer solution. You can actually start adding these good cuts that you can get for the deterministic to eliminate the capacity and subtour, so that it allow you to be able to go faster in order to determine the good feasible solution. So we embed that in a single Brandon Bao framework so that you don't need to explore, you know, multiple times of the in the classical Bender's decomposition context. And once you terminate this Brandon Bao, you guarantee having an optimal solution because you actually have a single Brandon Bao tree. So this is what we leverage in this type of context. So this type approach allow us to be able to tackle a larger instances as opposed to the one that have been addressed in other works in the literature. So in the first exercise that we did, we look back into some of the work. So we took the version of stochastic of Kenyon and Morton in 2003. They proposed one of the first model in this context. They used the big M model. They have they saw it using run and cut. They have one deadline in that setting, and then they actually use that formulation to actually solve this problem. So we actually implement two versions. The first version is that we use run and cut, but with our routing set, but then still with the big M constraint. So what it means is that we still keep all those scenarios that you see, we still keep it in the master problem. The second version is the version where we replace those big M constraint that check the deadline violation. And when we replace it by the logic cut that represent the violation based on a given root, so that you don't have many variables and many constraints in the master problem anymore. So we look into the computational aspect of this, and then we see that it's already a huge improvement. The first one comes from the fact that by being able to leverage the CVRP separation algorithms and cut that already exists in the deterministic VRP, we already improved quite substantially in terms of computational performance. And on top of that, by projecting out the uncertainty, it allows us to be able to solve the problem with a very large number of scenarios, because your problem would not the scalability would not be limited by the number of scenarios anymore. Then you will not suffer so much when you increase number of scenarios. So we can see that, for example, with 100 versus 1000, the CPU time increased, not so much in the framework that we project out those type of subproblem. And at the same time, we can also, address the problem with a large number of scenarios. So in this case, we also have one of them with 20,000, and we can still easily solve it, even this number of scenarios. For the robust way to routing, so we compare our formulation and this separation Bender's brand and cut approach together with the enhancement that we have versus the one that proposed in the original paper of Jay et al. In 2016. And we want to see how much performance we could actually improve. So you can see that with the original version of JQS and also our version of BBC, we can actually improve, for these cases, we improve about like 10 times of the CPU time. For the other cases, actually from average around 40 seconds to less than 1 second in our experiment, for the instance, with up to 80 customers. So in this one, we also show that our implementation and enhancement actually improved substantially the performance of the model when dealing with distributed robust optimization. All right. So this is a quick summary of what we achieved compared to the solution approaches in the literature. At the same time, we want to be able to address this question, because at that point, there were no comparison among these two different frameworks. So we want to see if whether or not the solution of the distribution is robust is actually quite reasonable and can also be practically used as opposed to the stochastic optimization. So we do a very simple experiment to explore that. So first of all, we want to actually see the robustness of our solution. But first of all, we want to see how good the robust solution is when you know the perfect information about a distribution. In the first set, right, we are going to assume that the underlying distribution is known, and in the training and evaluation, both are the same, right? So when the distribution are the same, we want to see how close the robust is compared to stochastic, because we know that stochastic have the entire information about distribution. So you can see that stochastic is actually better in terms of the probability, because that is the main objective that we look at. And also it better in 191 instances. But at the same time, robust optimization is not too far either. It's just a little bit worse. And at the same time, this quality of solution, so if you look into both triangular and uniform, it's still quite reasonable, even though we look into the case that we don't know exactly the distribution. On the other hand, when we change the distribution, if we assume that training is triangular, the evaluation is uniform, we look into the result, and we see that now the robust actually better when you cannot be confident about your distribution. And then we can actually see that the robust also outperform in terms of number of instances, a little bit less in the case of uniform in training and triangular in evaluation. But then we can actually see that even with less information to rely on, the solution that you get from robust is actually quite reasonable and not too far from the case when you know the full information. So those are the insights that we made in our paper in 2016. And then in our recent paper 2021, that just recently published this year, we actually want to explore the extension of the case that we do essentially with the deadline to the more general context, right? And we want to see how we can actually deal with that. So in this type of context, we are going to deal with the case that you're gonna have the time windows, all right? But the time window that we're gonna have gonna be solved. And at the same time, there's another decision that we have to make, which is the assignment of the time window. So you think about the case when you have some client call you, and then they ask for commitment to receive the service, and then you give them, hey, I'm gonna be there around 10:30. But then you're gonna have also at the same time some kind of implicit time window that you're supposed to be there between 10:30 and 11, right? It's kind of commitment that this would be the time that you expect to be there. So for each of the customer or each of the location, you're gonna be able to give them the commitment in terms of the time windows that you're gonna give to them, and you're gonna try your best in order to satisfy the time window that you give to them, right? The caveat here is that the size of the time window is actually fixed, right? It's not like you can actually have very large time window so that you can guarantee to satisfy. The size of time window is actually given and fixed. So if the size of time window is 30 minutes, what you can give them is that, I'm gonna be there at 10:30, so it means that you have to be there between 10:30 and 11, right? So the sign-up time window is fixed. So you must actually give a good time window to them and make sure that you can satisfy. So this happened in the context of, cash replenishment in Europe. That's the reason why, we have our collaborator, and it's actually the motivating problem that we look at. So in this cash replenishment operation, they have to tell different branches in terms of the time that they expect to arrive, right? And they want to be able to satisfy that as much as possible. At the same time, they just do not have infinite resources to dispatch so many vehicles, right? So they want to make sure that first of all, they can fully utilize the vehicle. Secondly, they can actually give the good time window so that the security person or some people who would be responsible to support those kind of operations can prepare themselves and be there on time. Right, so this kind of operation is also the motivating example of the application. And then there are also some other type of application you can think of, right, in terms of maybe the delivery services or the food delivery service as well. You may actually need to commit this type of short time window to the customer, and you want to make sure that you satisfy them as much as possible, right? The caveat here again is also the time window size is fixed and it's actually solved. So if you arrive early, we assume that you will be able to provide the service. This is another work by another group that look into the hard time window, and this is also a different type of context and operation. So just to give you a little bit of idea, there are a few works on the the vehicle routing with time window assignment. Unfortunately, most of the time, this work to like assume, as you know, like stochastic information using scenarios. So we want to actually enhance it and look into how we can actually extend it using the distribution in robots optimization framework. On the robots optimization framework, none of them actually address the issue of time window assignment. Most of them, you know, look into the case of the time window constraint as a given as a constraint, and want to make sure that they satisfy the time window. There is no decision around time window assignment. This is an interesting work by Sang et al. In 2019, and I think the second one published in 2020. The first one published in math programming, second one published in OR. They actually look into the case of hard time window constraint, and then they basically come up with a different risk index in order to tackle that. And then they look into what's the star ambiguity set. So that is a different context because the time window are constraint, there is no time window assignment, but at the same time, it's in a similar spirit of taking into account the time windows. I have this question: how do you communicate the delivery time constraint to your feature worker, your four-leg delivery assistant? I think that may be not a question. Yeah, so in reality, you would be able to, you know, that is the operation constraint, right? The time window size is 30 minutes, and then, you know, you want to make sure that when you communicate, you satisfy the time window. So I'm gonna go a little bit quickly on this part because the setting is similar. The only thing that make a huge difference is first, we need to have soft time window. So you're gonna have two functions. The first one is a deadline, right? The second one is the early arrival. You don't want to arrive too early. You don't want to arrive too late. So you have two kind of this utility function. One for the case of, you know, the end of time window, the other one for the case of the beginning of the time window. So that is the main modification we have to make. And then the part that become difficult is also basically, so first of all, the other thing that we have to assume is basically, we also want to make sure that we constrain the expected time to serve all the vehicles, right? Otherwise, you may actually come up with a solution that is so conservative, then you dispatch so many vehicles and like you spend too much time in terms of the expected value on the route. And then just for the sake of being able to give the good time windows and being able to satisfy the time window, but maybe the cost of operation is gonna be too high. So we also have the constraint to limit that give the trade-off in terms of the expected, you know, the length of the route that you can actually use. So that is the maximum expected total time that we add on top of that to make sure that solution will not be too bad in terms of operational constraint. So the thing that we have to make, in fact, come from the fact that instead of looking into one risk net index, and in that sense, in the previous one, in order to derive the subgradient cut, in order to have the derivative for those functions, for those one, it's quite easy because you have only one variable to search. It's only the risk index for each location. When you have one variable to search, then you can use something very simple like bin search or some algorithm to actually, you know, determine the alpha value for each location. You use that and then you derive the subgradient cut. In this context, it becomes more difficult because you're gonna have two indexes, one for the deadline, the other one for the early arrival. And the third one, you're gonna need to search for the time window commitment as well. When would be the time that you're gonna give to your client at the commitment in terms of time window assignment? So three values need to be dealt with in the subproblem. So in order to do that, first of all, again, we establish the slater condition in the master to make sure that expected value of arrival gonna stay within the time window that you give. And also that also allow us to be able to use the, you know, dual forms of the subproblem. And then we saw by the brand and vendor's cut, in order to deal with, you know, these three index, we need to come up with different algorithms in order to search for the optimal of three value at the same time in the subproblem. And we actually come up with the modified search algorithm that guarantee optimality by looking into the point that satisfy these three conditions. So the first and second condition is very simple. You want to make sure that you know, you set the this utility function equal to the either the beginning of time window and the end of the time window for those two different risk index, one for early arrival, the other one for the delay. And then the third one is basically you want to ensure that derivative of the two values of this function for the beginning of time window and end of time window are basically equal. The logic of the third one is that when you try to satisfy one, you know, if you want to arrive early, you may have higher risk of arriving too early, right? If you try to put your arrival a little bit later, then you're gonna have higher likelihood that you're gonna arrive late. So this third condition guarantee that the point that you're gonna get will be the optimal point so that by improving one will not sacrifice the other, right? It's a point where the two would be equivalent and you would not, you know, be able to further optimize it. So the third condition guarantee that. So by doing that, now we have the three parameters that we need, and then we can derive our subgradient path. We become more sophisticated, but you know, those are just like the derivative result of those known parameters. So based on that, we use the framework that we had with, you know, the subgradient cut, but with you know, the version for this time window assignments, and then we look into how much we can get in terms of the risk and cost trade-off. One thing I want to point out is that by using this framework, by giving up a little bit of, you know, operating cost, it turned out that you can save so much in terms of reducing the risk. Like in some cases with 4% operating cost increase, you save about 50%, 52% in terms of the risk reduction in terms of looking into the risk of violating the time windows. So we look into the robustness in similar settings, similar conclusion, robust distribution, robust, a little bit inferior when you know exactly the distribution, and basically superior when you basically do not know the distribution. I think that is like a natural conclusion when you actually look into this type of problem, right? So those are the things that we have. And then our framework is also shown to be like quite scalable, even this complex decision of time window assignment and, you know, the soft time windows. Thank you very much. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask.
Thank you very much, Yossiri. So are there questions? We have a little bit of time. So again, either write it through the chat or raise your hand. So maybe I have one, if I may. So just to, Raf is asking a question. So I'll give the priority to Raf and then...
go ahead first, Walter. Walter, you go first.
Okay. So a quick question, Yossiri. So in the branch and cut method that you showed, so if I understood the general strategy, you're adding CVRP cuts at the beginning, then you get a route, and once you get a route, then you switch to the checking the deadlines and so forth.
Yes.
So just maybe an open question here. So I know that in other stochastic VRP settings, there is value in trying to provide cuts, lower bounding functionals that are based on partial routes. So routes that are partially established. Would that concept work here also, or?
Yeah, I believe it would work. We didn't use that though, but the paper, you know, the other paper that deal with the hard time window, they also leverage, you know, that property and that, you know, observation in terms of generating cut. I would believe it would also help, you know, improving quite substantially, and that would also be an interesting idea to explore. We haven't done that just by the fact that we started with this. It seemed to work well, and then we continued with that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. No, because it would be a way to, let's say, eliminate poor solutions, poor routes, routes that could be eliminated quickly.
Yeah, very good idea, yes.
So, Raf and then Sven.
A quick question. You compare the stochastic approach to the robust approach, and in the stochastic approach, you were saying that you minimize the sum of the probabilities of violations because you have multiple deadlines, let's say. Would you get, let's say, something closer to, let's say, a robust, let's say, schedule if you would minimize the, let's say, the maximum probability of violation or something like that?
The version that would be equivalent would be like I think the tardiness would be more equivalent, but well, I think the version that would be the most equivalent could probably be C bar rather than the probability. We didn't explore like in the perspective of like a more equivalent objectives. We just simply at that point we want to actually scale the version that has been proposed, which is a probability. But indeed, actually in the second work we did that. In the second work we compared the stochastic with the more equivalent objective, and this is how the result looked like. But so we look into the risk function but with known distribution as the measure of the quality of solution, and still the conclusion is still quite similar. So in the second paper, we did it in a way that we have equivalent objective of both versions.
Okay, thank you very much.
I think this is another person.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, I was interested in your logic-based bender where you're just searching a single tree. Do you have things like cut management where you're looking at removing cuts as well, or putting them into a bin so that they're not used, because that makes the relaxation solve faster? And mm-hmm. Do you have any insight as to where the cuts, where the most useful cuts are generated in terms of where you are in the tree? Is it sort of at the top of the tree where you generate useful cuts, or is it further down?
That is a great question. We try to actually, think about, reflect when we work on the second one. We didn't come up with a way to remove, we simply add. That would also be another great idea to explore. We haven't that much of a cut management just by the fact that basically it turned out that most of the time they are not, maybe like in the instance that we explore, they are not like too many cut. The fact that we start from a CVRP cut also helps speed up so much, so that each of the feasible solution we get, is already feasible in terms of the routing. And basically after that, the cut, like in particular in the case of disability robust, the subgradient cut seem to work very well. So we didn't really try to remove anything because just the volume of the cuts, it's not like too much to handle.
Okay.
Any other questions from the audience? So if not, the breakout rooms are open. I don't know if you have time, Yossiri, to stay a bit.
Yeah, I have time, yes.
So we'd be happy to. Maybe chat in breakout room number one, as we have been doing since the beginning of the week. So if there are no other questions, we'll end there. Thank you again, Yossiri, for the very nice presentation.